first lecture series. Our new topic is orofacial and neck infections. This lecture is intended to introduce you to the facial layers of the neck, which is also called as cervical fascia. First, you should understand what the term fascia means. Fascia is a band or sheet of connective tissue, primarily of collagen, and it is found beneath the skin. And what are its functions? The fascia attaches, stabilizes, encloses and separates the muscles and other internal organs. There is one more term that you need to be familiar with, that is facial space. These are potential spaces that exist between the fascia and underlying organs and other tissues. And they are separated from each other by barriers, which may be a muscle, a bone, or fascia. Any odontogenic infection can reach these facial spaces, resulting in space infection. Generally, the spread of infection is determined based on whether the anatomical barrier. It can be a muscle, bone, or fascia. So it depends on the anatomical barrier whether it is breached or not. What is the significance of these facial spaces or space infection? Space infections are relatively common sequelae of odontogenic infection and rapidly progressing, which results in prolonged morbidity. There are long-term complications associated with space infections, which are potentially life-threatening. The treatment of space infections are also considered to be difficult due to various factors, like the complexity of the anatomy of neck, the deeper location of the spaces, limited access, proximity to vital structures, and communication of spaces with each other. So that said, let's have a look at the cervical fascia in detail. Cervical fascia is divided into superficial cervical fascia and deep cervical fascia. Superficial cervical fascia is a thin layer of subcutaneous connective tissue that lies between the dermis of the skin and the first layer of deep cervical fascia, which is the investing layer. It contains the following: the neurovascular supply to the skin, superficial veins and lymph nodes, fat and platysma muscle. Superficial cervical fascia is thinner on the anterior aspect of the neck, and it has usually got very thin amount of fat, which is its distinguishing characteristic. At the anterior neck, the superficial fascia blends with the platysma. Platysma is a broad superficial muscle which originates from the fascia over the pectoralis major and deltoid. The fibers of platysma then crosses the clavicle and meet in the midline, fusing with the muscles of the face. It is beneath the superficial cervical fascia that you can find the external jugular vein. Beneath the superficial cervical fascia, you find the deep cervical fascia. The deep cervical fascia, as its name suggests, lies deep to the superficial cervical fascia and the platysma muscle. This fascia is organized into several layers, and each of these layers have a role in supporting the neck structures. We shall now have a look at each of these layers in detail. From here onwards, you will see the same diagram in every following slide throughout this presentation, because this is the best way to visualize and compare the facial layers at a glance. Before looking into the diagram, let us understand that any object or human body can be visualized in three different planes: the sagittal, coronal and transverse planes. The sagittal plane divides the human body into equal right and left halves through the midline. Sagittal plane is shown in red color here. The coronal plane divides the human body into anterior and posterior halves, or anterior and posterior parts. transverse plane, also called the axial plane or cross-sectional plane, divides the body into inferior and superior portion. So this is applicable to human body as well as any object. So keep this image in mind while discussing the topic proper images. This figure shows the cross-sectional image of neck at the level of 7th cervical vertebra or the C7. You have sectioned the neck at the level of C7 and you are viewing it from above. This is a superior view. So let's see what all structures you can identify here. Because this is sectioned at C7 level, here is the 7th vertebra. And through the center runs the spinal cord. This is the spinal cord, this is the C7 vertebra. So to identify the structures, let's move from anterior to posterior. This is the anterior aspect, this is the posterior aspect. So anteriorly you can visualize the superficial cervical fascia with the platysma. This muscle is the platysma. The thin muscle over here is the platysma, and around it you have the superficial cervical fascia. You know from the previous slide that platysma is the limit of superficial cervical fascia. Beneath the platysma, you can identify the external jugular vein. The deep cervical fascia begins at the investing layer, which is shown in green color. So investing layer surrounds the entire neck. As you can see very clearly here, the investing layer, which is green in color, surrounds the entire cross section of the neck. You can see the sternocleidomastoid muscle on either side and also the smaller infrahyoid muscles. These are the infrahyoid muscles, the ones smaller in size. As you move further deeper, the structure in pink here is the thyroid. This overlies the trachea, which is blue in color. This is thyroid, this is trachea, and the structure behind the trachea in red color is the esophagus. So the thyroid, the trachea and esophagus are enclosed within the second layer of deep cervical fascia, which is the pretracheal layer, that is illustrated in blue color here. As you still go posteriorly, there is carotid sheath, which is red in color on either side, and the carotid sheath encloses the common carotid artery, the internal jugular vein and the vagus nerve. Orange colored layer here is the prevertebral fascia. There are different groups of muscles around the cervical vertebra, which is enclosed by the prevertebral fascia. And most posteriorly, you can see that the investing layer of deep cervical fascia has split itself to enclose the trapezius muscle. So this is the description of deep cervical fascia in a nutshell. Moving on to the investing layer of deep cervical fascia, which is depicted in blue color here. It is the most superficial aspect of the deep cervical fascia and is clearly seen in the diagram here, that it surrounds all the structures in the neck like a collar. Here again is a cross-sectional view of the neck at C7 level. This is the anterior part, here is the posterior part. And where the investing fascia meets the trapezius muscle and the sternocleidomastoid muscle, it splits into two and it completely surrounds both the muscles. So imagine the investing fascia as a cube with superior, inferior, anterior and posterior attachments. In the cross-sectional image, you cannot see the superior and inferior limits. Therefore, here is the sagittal view. The green color here is the investing fascia. Superiorly, it is attached to the external occipital protuberance, the superior nuchal line of the skull, the mastoid process, and the base of the mandible. That is the superior limit. Anteriorly, the limit is the hyoid bone and the symphysis menti. Posteriorly, it is attached along the nuchal line of the vertebral column and the spine of C7. It is attached to the ligamentum nuchae and the spine of 7th cervical vertebra. Inferiorly, the limit is the manubrium sternae. So these are the attachments of investing layer of deep cervical fascia. Just like the investing fascia splits to enclose two muscles, that is the sternocleidomastoid muscle and the trapezius muscle, similarly the fascia also splits to enclose two glands. Those are the submandibular and submental glands and two spaces, the suprasternal and supraclavicular spaces. So these are the structures or the regions surrounded by or enclosed by the investing layer of deep cervical fascia. The second layer or the pretracheal layer of deep cervical fascia. In the sagittal view here, the pretracheal layer is depicted in blue color. This is situated in the anterior neck and it extends between the hyoid bone and the oblique line of thyroid cartilage superiorly and thorax inferiorly, where it blends with the pericardium of the arch of the aorta. In the cross-sectional image, the pretracheal layer fuses with the carotid sheath deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So here is the carotid sheath to which the pretracheal layer is blended on either side. So here in this diagram, you can see that the pretracheal layer has enclosed few muscles over here. These are the infrahyoid muscles. It has also enclosed the thyroid gland, the trachea and the esophagus. Therefore, anatomically, pretracheal fascia can be divided into two parts, the muscular part and the visceral part. The muscular part encloses the infrahyoid muscles and the visceral part encloses the thyroid, trachea and the esophagus. There are few other features of the pretracheal layer. On either side of the thyroid gland, it forms a suspensory ligament for the gland which is known as the ligament of Berry. This ligament is attached to the cricoid cartilage and also to the thyroid cartilage. So its function is to support the thyroid gland and the thyroid doesn't sink into the mediastinum. This fascia also provides a slippery surface for the free movement of the trachea during swallowing. Moving on to the prevertebral layer. As the name suggests, it lies in front of the prevertebral muscles and forms the floor of the posterior triangle of the neck. As you can see here, the purple colored is the prevertebral fascia and the prevertebral muscles lie between the fascia and the vertebra, which is colored in pink. There are three sets of muscles associated with this fascia. The first group of muscles is located anterior to the vertebrae and it includes the longus capitis and longus colli muscles. The second group of muscle is the scalenus muscles, which include the anterior, middle and posterior scalenes as well as the levator scapulae, which is located laterally to the vertebra. And posteriorly, the deep muscles or intrinsic muscles of the back are located. The sagittal section shows the prevertebral fascia in brown color. Superiorly, it is attached to the skull base and inferiorly, it extends to the superficial mediastinum where it is attached to the body of the Fourth, thoracic vertebra. Anteriorly, the prevertebral fascia is separated from the pharynx and buccopharyngeal fascia by the retropharyngeal space containing loose areolar tissues. This is the sagittal view, and here is the cross-sectional view of the same region. So prevertebral fascia is illustrated in blue color, and the orange color shows the retropharyngeal space. Anterior to the retropharyngeal space is the buccopharyngeal fascia. So this space differentiates or separates the buccopharyngeal fascia from the prevertebral fascia. This region is of utmost importance in dealing with or while dealing with space infections. The importance of this region will be dealt in detail in the subsequent lectures. The next layer of deep cervical fascia is the carotid sheath. It is paired and present on either side of the neck. The carotid sheath encloses the internal jugular vein, the common carotid artery, and the vagus nerve. In addition, it has relations to ansa cervicalis anteriorly and the cervical sympathetic chain posteriorly. The carotid sheath is formed by the fusion of pretracheal investing layer and the prevertebral layers of deep cervical fascia. It is within this carotid sheath that the common carotid artery bifurcates into the internal and external carotid artery. It is only the internal carotid artery that is present within the sheath. The same diagram is depicted here. This is the internal jugular vein, the common carotid artery, the ansa cervicalis, and the sympathetic trunk. As you can see here, the carotid sheath is organized into a column. So the superior limit of the sheath is the base of the skull, and the inferior limit is the thoracic mediastinum. And this particular organization is of clinical significance as a pathway for the spread of infection. Buccopharyngeal fascia wraps around the lateral and posterior sides of the pharynx, and it lies on the superficial side of the pharyngeal constrictor muscle. It was told earlier that the prevertebral fascia is separated from the buccopharyngeal fascia by the retropharyngeal space. Again, there is alar fascia, which is red in color, which is present between the retropharyngeal space and the prevertebral fascia. As you can see here, the red colored structure is the alar fascia, which lies just posterior to the retropharyngeal space. So these structures will prevent the meeting or communication between the two fascias, that is the prevertebral fascia and the buccopharyngeal fascia. But there is one point where the alar fascia fuses with the retropharyngeal space. As you can see here, at this particular point, the alar fascia and the retropharyngeal space, or it is retropharyngeal fascia as you can call it, either way. So at this point, both the fascias meet, and here ends the retropharyngeal space. So it is probably at this level that the prevertebral fascia communicates with the buccopharyngeal fascia, as you can see in this diagram. Here is the midline fusion between the prevertebral fascia and the buccopharyngeal fascia, which is at a variable level between the sixth cervical vertebrae, that is C6, and the fourth thoracic vertebrae, T4. So this meeting point of the prevertebral fascia and the buccopharyngeal fascia is somewhere between C6 and T4. Pharyngobasilar fascia is the thickened part of the deep cervical fascia, between the upper border of the superior constrictor muscle and the base of the skull. This lies deep to the pharyngeal muscles. This figure again depicts the relationship between the prevertebral fascia, the buccopharyngeal fascia, and the pharyngobasilar fascia. The dark blue color is the prevertebral fascia, the light blue is the buccopharyngeal fascia, which will eventually meet somewhere between C6 and T4. Between the pharyngobasilar and the buccopharyngeal fascia lies the constrictor muscles of the pharynx. So this is how all the three fascia, the buccopharyngeal, pharyngobasilar and prevertebral fascia are related. So that's all about the facial layers of neck in brief. In subsequent lectures, we shall discuss in detail the clinical significance of important facial spaces and how odontogenic infection spreads to each of them. Thank you.